And thanks everyone for joining, because I can see it's a great lineup. So I'm really glad that you're here to find out why we need to talk about cancer in the workplace. I'm the lead cancer nurse at Perci Health, which is a virtual cancer care clinic. And I've been a cancer nurse for 20 years, working in the NHS, supporting people impacted by cancer in a variety of different settings. And I'm also somebody who has personally returned to work after a cancer diagnosis. So I'm really passionate about talking about cancer at work, because I know work was really important to me. Getting back to a job I loved was really important to me. And I know from talking to people over the last 20 years that people affected by cancer want to work, and it's important for them too. So what I'm hoping we'll cover in the session is that we'll understand how the changing cancer landscape means that it's becoming an increasing burden for people in the workplace. Then we'll look at the different groups of people who are impacted. So you might be able to get an idea of these groups within your organisation and how you might be able to identify them. And then we're going to consider the costs of cancer to your organisation and how you might measure it. And then we'll finish off with how you might review your current offering and the current way you support people with cancer across the spectrum. So I want to start, if it's okay with you, by just sharing this video, which I think is a real powerful illustration on the impacts of cancer on people at work.
Change your heart. Look around you. Change your heart. It will astound you. And I need your loving like the sunshine.
So some of you might have seen that video before. It was developed as part of the publicist group campaign, Working with Cancer campaign, which pledges to reduce the stigma of cancer at work and to create more supportive environments at work for people affected by cancer. And before we go on, I just wondered if we might just take a quick show of hands, if you will, of anyone who's been impacted by cancer or knows someone that's been impacted by cancer. Okay, so I think that is pretty much everyone, and sadly it does impact us all, but we still find that it can be an uncomfortable thing to talk about. When we talk about somebody having cancer, we might use slightly hushed tones in a way that we wouldn't necessarily do if we were talking about somebody who'd had a heart attack. And as we start to address taboos, previous taboos like menopause and mental health, we need to really start taking the same approach towards cancer as well. So in order for you to understand the growing burden of cancer in the workplace, we need to understand how the cancer landscape is changing. And I think a lot of people know this statistic now, that one in two people will be diagnosed with cancer in their lifetime. But the good news is that survival rates have more than doubled. So if you're diagnosed with cancer today, you've got a 68% chance of surviving more than 5 years, and 50% of people will live for more than 10 years. So all of this means that there's more people living with and beyond cancer. And cancer's really been classified now and perhaps managed more as a long-term condition than perhaps it has been before. And because of this growing number of people living with and after cancer, this is pushing up healthcare costs. And the main drivers of these costs are the drugs and targeted medicines that now form part of this era of personalised medicine. So they've been the main drivers over the last 10 years. New targeted therapies that cost tens of thousands of pounds per cycle, and treatment that can go on for many years. So an individual who's having cancer treatment can really push up an organisation's PMI premiums, for example. And then there are the healthcare costs associated with the long-term survivorship. So by 2030, it's estimated that 6% of the population will be living with or after cancer. That's about 4 million people. And there are increased healthcare costs associated with that, because people who've had a cancer diagnosis, their healthcare costs are 2 to 4 times higher than that of somebody who hasn't had cancer. And that's not only during the period that they're on treatment, but this continues for many years after. And cancer has a large ripple effect, and maybe affecting different groups within your organisation. So I think it's worth taking a moment to consider who these groups might be. So we've got this first group of those who are newly diagnosed or perhaps are undergoing active treatment at the moment, and that's likely to be about 1 to 2% of your workforce in any given year. These people need a lot of support. And then we've got people living with and beyond cancer. So these people might have finished their active cancer treatment and they're moving on to maintenance treatment, and they still need a lot of support, perhaps with returning to work. And this is likely to represent an additional 3 to 5% of your workforce. And cancer's not a visible condition necessarily. You can't tell just by looking at someone if they've had cancer. So this group might be harder to identify unless they come forward and ask for help. But we know, again, they are 10 times more likely to be affected by ongoing physical and psychological ill health that leads to absence from work. And then we've got family members and carers who are also impacted by their loved one's cancer diagnosis. And again, this is likely to represent about 10% of your workforce. And I'll pick up a bit more about them in the next slide, as we know from our research with employers that you've identified that you feel there's a gap for carers who are caring for someone with cancer. You've also got people in your organisation who may be worried about cancer, either because they've got some troubling symptoms, or they've got a strong family history of cancer, or maybe they're waiting on some screening results. And there are also managers and colleagues of the person who's impacted, because it does affect them as well. So yeah, a little bit more about carers. It's estimated at the last count that there are around 1.5 million cancer carers in the UK. And this is likely to be a real underestimate, because most people who are caring for someone with cancer, they don't identify with that term of being a carer. They're just looking after someone that they love. And traditional healthcare really does overlook this group in its provision. And again, we know that this group is more likely to need absence from work because of psychological and physical illness. So what does this group of cancer carers look like? Well, 67% of them are women. 67% of them are working age, 68% are women, 90% of whom are juggling work and childcare as well. 42% are from ethnic minority groups. But really interestingly, the majority, so 67% of cancer carers, feel that work really gives them a break from their caring role. So work is really important to carers. And cancer is a real complex condition that needs specialist support. It has physical, psychological, and practical impacts on the person with cancer and also the people around them. And these impacts are all really individual to that person, and they can continue well after treatment and have long-term implications. And they're not always obvious to people around them. So examples of physical impacts might be things like cancer-related fatigue, treatment-induced menopause, increased risk of infection, and then in terms of the psychological impacts, fear of recurrence is something that is people report as a real problem. Fear of recurrence means fear of cancer coming back, and this can lead to generalized anxiety and also a loss of confidence. And also the practical impact, so things like remaining or returning to work, family issues, maybe talking to children about cancer. And also, I think, financial difficulties. I don't think we should underestimate the impact on the individual of a cancer diagnosis in terms of their finances. The stats tell us that 83% of people who are impacted by cancer take a financial hit. And in some cases, that's up to £800-900 a month for extra travelling costs and potential loss of income. So we need to keep that in mind. And all of this is compounded by the NHS crisis. So half of employees say they've been affected by NHS delays, and one in five of those people say that these delays have meant their work has been affected. And if we take an example of a person who's coming to the end of their treatment, they're moving into long-term follow-up and surveillance with their cancer care team. This is in particular a time that people report feeling abandoned, feeling like they're falling off a cliff because that intense support they've had from their treating team falls away. But they've still got healthcare needs. They've still potentially got side effects. And they're not always clear about when to contact their team. They might find accessing their GP difficult. So some of these side effects and ongoing issues remain unaddressed. And this can lead to people needing to take additional time off work or not being able to return to work, and even in some cases, leaving their jobs. And all of this means that it's estimated that the total cost to the UK productivity is £7.6 billion in relation to cancer. And these gaps in traditional healthcare mean that your employees may be falling through the cracks of your existing strategies for health and well-being. And that's because they need cancer-specific support from cancer experts. So if you have a mental health policy and you may be able to access psychological support, is that a cancer expert? Are they professionals working who have worked and experienced with cancer patients? You might have physical health strategy. Maybe you can access physiotherapy through your private medical insurance, but that physiotherapist won't be a cancer specialist. And again, in terms of your financial support that you're offering your employees, is it really focused on the specific needs of people impacted by cancer? So I think the key here is to mitigate the financial and human cost of cancer in your organisation by really providing expert support and care, and looking at plugging the gaps that there may already be in your provision, and avoiding any duplication of support that you already have. Because not only does it make business sense to address the needs of employees affected by cancer, but it makes a real difference to those individual employees because they want to work. 87% of people with a cancer diagnosis say it was really important to them either to carry on working or return to work, as it gave them a sense of normality, it's part of their sense of identity, it gives them a sense of self. And that's really echoed here in Julia's quote, in that she wanted to be working when she was going to need chemotherapy and radiotherapy, as she loved doing it, and it would help her feel that life was carrying on as normal. So when you are considering how you can offer support to people impacted by cancer, it's really necessary to think about the whole cancer spectrum. So from prevention through detection, diagnosis, treatment and survivorship. And these are some of the things that you might be considering. So in terms of prevention, we know that 30 to 50% of cancers are preventable with healthy lifestyle changes. So your targeted health and well-being education, if it's focusing on healthy eating, exercise, smoking cessation, that can have a real impact in prevention. What do you offer in terms of detection and diagnosis? Are you making sure your employees get to their screening programs? Do you help them understand what they should be accessing through the NHS? Do you actually have any enhanced screening program offerings within the organisation? And do you offer access to virtual GPs who can potentially expedite this part of the process? And in terms of treatment, do you have private medical insurance cover? Is it for the whole of workforce? What are the restrictions? And do you have any group income protection that might offer a level of cancer support as well? And in terms of your cancer policy, do you have a cancer policy? Is this something that this needs to be something where people would understand what the impacts would be on them in terms of what they would be entitled to and how it might affect their pay? And it could also support your line managers in terms of being able to understand what they can offer their team members. And training needs to go alongside that. And in terms of survivorship, can you offer access to personalised, multi-professional, multidisciplinary rehabilitation in order to keep people or help people get back to work? This supporting in the return to work is really an area that's just not covered in traditional healthcare. And it becomes a psychological issue for people. So what do you currently offer people in this time of return to work for people who've been affected by cancer? So there is lots that you can do to support people. But if there are three key things that I would suggest that you start with, I would say that they would be to start talking about cancer, create a cancer positive culture, and look at training for your leaders on how to have supportive conversations. Review your current employee cover. What have you got? What is missing? And think how you can cost effectively fill in any gaps. And then get some data. So understanding the impact in your organisation, because cancer is costly, if you can understand the implications and how much it's costing you, then you can really build a case for how offering very supportive cancer care adds value to your organisation. So thank you very much for listening. I hope you've taken away why we need to start talking about cancer. And that you've got some ideas on how you might review what you're currently offering.